नमस्ते, दिस इज हरीश सर फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग, विवेकानंद कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग टेक्नोलॉजी, पुत्तूर, दक्षिण कन्नड़ा। दिस प्रेजेंटेशन इज ऑन मेटल कास्टिंग एंड वेल्डिंग सब्जेक्ट। आई एम गोइंग टू डील विद मॉड्यूल 5। दिस इज द पार्ट 1 ऑफ द सीरीज वेयर आई एम गोइंग टू कवर द मेटलर्जिकल एस्पेक्ट्स इन वेल्डिंग। And later I'll be releasing part 2 and part 3 as well. All the narrations have been referred from a book on manufacturing process 1 by Dr. K. Radhakrishna. In the previous module, you had discussed about what is welding and what are the different types of welding. In this module, we'll be discussing about the metallurgical aspects in welding. First, we'll move on with the formation of different zones in welding. During the welding process, when the heat interacts with the workpiece material, the flow of temperature in the material varies from region to region, resulting in three distinct regions or zones. They are the fusion zone, the heat affected zone, and the base metal zone. As you can see in the figure on the slide, all the three regions are shown here. The center part where the weld bead is there, that is called the fusion zone, and the dotted line represents the heat affected zone and finally the base metal zone. Now let's see one by one. Zone 1 is the fusion zone. Fusion zone is the molten metal itself. More specifically, it is the region where the molten metal of the pillar rod combines with the molten metal of the workpiece to form the weld. The fusion zone can be considered similar to a casting process wherein the workpiece metal reaches to molten state and then allowed to cool. Hence, the metal in the fusion zone has basically a cast structure with a microstructure reflecting the cooling rate in the weld. The properties of the fusion zone depend primarily on the filler metal used and its compatibility with the workpiece material. Next, zone 2, heat affected zone. The fusion zone is surrounded by the heat affected zone. The portion that was not melted but subjected to elevated temperatures for a brief period of time. As a result, these portions experience changes in its microstructure and mechanical properties. The extent and magnitude to which the change occurs depend primarily on the type of base metal and the amount of concentration of heat input at the joint. The metal in this area is often weaker than both the base metal and the weld metal, and it is also where the residual stresses are found. Moving on to zone 3, base metal zone. Base metal zone is the portion around the heat affected zone which remains unaffected as it is not heated sufficiently to change its microstructure. Present slide shows you the different zones in axle. In the center you can see the weld bead, that is nothing but the fusion zone, and the color which has been changed. Where you can see a brown boundary over there, the dark blue boundary, that is called as the heat affected zone, and out of that is the base metal zone where no effect of temperature has been done. Now let's discuss about the structure of weld in these zones. Coming to the fusion zone, during welding, a small portion of the edges of the workpiece, nothing but the fusion zone, will be melted followed by immediate and fast cooling of the molten metal. Hence, the microstructure development in this region depends on the solidification behavior of the molten metal. The solidification process is similar to that of the casting and begins with the formation of the columnar or dendritic grain. As shown in the figure in the deep weld. Along the fusion line, the growth rate is low, while the temperature gradient is steeper. Grains appear at the line of fusion and as the weld center line is approached, the growth rate increases while the temperature gradient decreases. Consequently, the microstructure that develops varies noticeably from the edges to the center line of the weld. The grains formed are relatively long and parallel to the feed flow. The grain structure and size depends on the type of welding process employed, filler material used, and the alloy being melted. Adjacent portions of the weld metal, that is the heat affected zone, coarse grains are formed as a result of overheating. Now the structural changes in the heat affected zone. Welding makes use of intense heat to melt the edges of the workpiece material being joined. But during the process, the portion of the base metal adjacent to the edges being joined also gets heated to varied temperatures. As a result, these portions experience change in its microstructure and mechanical properties. The extent and magnitude to which the change occurs depends primarily on the type of base metal and the amount and concentration of the heat input at the joint. Thus, heat affected zone can be defined as a portion of the base metal which has not been melted but whose microstructure and mechanical properties have been altered due to heat of welding. The heat affected zone is often the weakest part in the welded metal because it neither possesses the property of the base metal nor that of the solidified weld metal. Consequently, heat affected zone forms the region for the most of the failures in a welded joint. As discussed earlier, the heat affected zone is the weakest part in any welded joint. Usually, the component fails in this region as the microstructure is coarse in nature and is also weak. So, in order to have a good component or a good joint, it is very much necessary to reduce the heat affected zone. So, we need to see on what factors this heat affected zone is based. So, here are some factors or the parameters which are affecting the heat affected zone. The first one is the thermal diffusivity of the material. If the thermal diffusivity is high, then the HAZ will be relatively small. On the counterpart, if it is low, the HAZ will be larger. So, whenever we are selecting for joining process through welding, we should see that the material should have a very high thermal diffusivity. The next point is the heat input, that is the process by which we are going to do the welding. The welding type. Some of the welding processes supplies more and wider amount of heat, like oxy-fuel welding, electroslag welding, etc., leading to a larger HAZ. On the other round, we have some processes like laser welding, electron beam welding, etc., which supplies very minimal and concentrated amount of heat to the workpiece, which in turn reduces the area of HAZ. There are some other welding processes like arc welding, which falls between these two extremes, neither too large HAZ nor too small HAZ. And the third factor is the welding speed. Although we have to use the optimum speed to get a good weld, it should be seen that the welding speed should not be very slow, because slow welding speed gives a large HAZ or the heat affected zone. Therefore, optimum welding speed has to be used in order to reduce the heat affected zone.
Let's see the effect of carbon content on structure and properties of steel. Steel is most widely used material in welding compared to other materials. Steel may be defined as a refined pig iron or an alloy of iron and carbon. Various elements like sulfur, manganese, phosphorus, etc. are added to steel in order to impart the properties like hardenability, strength, hardness, weldability, wear resistance, etc. Of all the constituents, carbon is the most important ingredient in steel because it has a direct effect on the physical properties of the steel. Steel with low carbon content is similar to iron. More carbon content imparts hardness and strength. It is more difficult to weld. The carbon content in steel should be suitably controlled to obtain favorable properties. Now let's discuss about the finger in welds. Welding involves highly localized heating of metals being joined together. During welding, when the weld metal is deposited and the base metal is heated, and thus it expands. But on cooling, the base metal plus the weld metal shrinks. It is obvious that the shrinkage of the welded joint is far greater than the expansion. The shrinkage in turn introduces residual stress distortion, which is a major problem in welding. Shrinkage is an inherent property of any metal and hence cannot be prevented but can be controlled. There are various methods that can be used at the design stage or in the welding shops to minimize the effects caused by the shrinkage. Here are the few methods in which we can reduce the shrinkage in welds. The first method being avoiding the overwelding. Do not overweld any part. That is, less amount of metal, less shrinkage forces will act on that. So you have to see that overwelding is avoided. Second method to reduce shrinkage is intermittent welding instead of continuous welding. Wherever it is possible, you go for intermittent welding rather than continuous welding, which reduces the metal deposition rate. And the third method is the minimum number of passes. Try to reduce the number of passes as much as possible to get a good weld. Again, this being reducing the amount of metal deposition, thus reduces the shrinkage in welds. And the next method is a good weld design. This can be done at the design stage itself, that is, we should do the welding near the neutral axis, as much as possible near the neutral axis. And this can be done only in the design stage. This cannot be taken care afterwards. The next method in reducing the shrinkage in weld is balancing the weld around the neutral axis. This method again has to be done during the design stage itself, and this balancing helps in reducing the distortion in the weld. And the last method is pre-bending method, wherein an effort is made to minimize the shrinkage effects. Pre-bending is as shown in the figure there, making use of opposing mechanical forces to counteract distortion due to shrinkage effect. Clamps, jigs or fixtures may be used to hold the workpiece until the welding is completed. When the clamp is released, the plate returns to the flat shape, allowing the weld to relieve its shrinkage stresses. As discussed earlier, any amount of control methods we use to reduce the shrinkage effect, but it cannot be minimized to zero. And after welding, there will be some residual stresses remaining in the weld. So let us see what is this residual stresses are. The metal expands due to heating and solidifies under cooling during the welding process. These heating and cooling process induces residual stress in the material. And these residual stresses are independent of the applied load. What are the different effects of residual stresses? This results in distortion of the component, reduces the strength of the base material. This leads to failure of the material, lowers the ductility of the metal, and
This may increase the rate of damage by fatigue, creep, or environmental effects. So in order to overcome all these, we should make a try to reduce the residual stresses or to remove the residual stresses after the welding is being done. The residual stresses have to be relieved later on once the welding is completed. So what are the different methods in which we can reduce the residual stresses are peening and heat treatment. Now let's see what is peening. Peening, also known as hammering of the weld metal with blunt tip round edge hammer, will cause the metal to stretch and make it thinner, and it relieves the stresses. But care should be taken that it should be done very carefully, only on the metal which possesses ductility, otherwise the weld may break. Next method is heat treatment. As you all know, the heat treatment processes, it involves the technique of controlling the temperature of the weld metal. It is heated and cooled in such a way that which affects minimum surface area and removes the stresses.